Assalamu alaikum class. Today we are going to start a very important topic, not only from examination point of view, but from the practical point of view as well. We are going to start the research methodology. As I have already mentioned that we will be conducting a project of research which will carry 10 marks and it will be included in your final prof. Your major viva will be conducted on research methodology, epidemiology and biostats, which carry a great weightage. And throughout the year, we will be visiting research methodology again and again. So today I will give you just an introduction that how will you define a research, what are different types of research, what are different steps of conduction of research, how the research conduction is different from research write-up. These are basically two different things, but whenever we talk generally about research, people confuse or students confuse about the steps of conduction and steps of write-up. So we will be discussing that what is the difference between the two, and then we will be discussing that how do we select a title for our research. Let me emphasize again, class, it is a very, very important lecture and it will clarify many of your concepts. It will make the base of research methodology. So please be vigilant with this lecture. So the first question which comes to our mind when we talk about research methodology is that how do we define research? So research is basically defined as a systematic way of data collection, which is a scientific data, its collection, its analysis, its interpretation, and then interpreting it in such a way that we want to find out solutions to the problem which originated this research question. So ideally, whenever we want to conduct research, we should know that we have to define a research question. Then we will collect scientific data on that question. And this data collection will be done in a very systematic way. After collection of data, we use different softwares for the analysis of the data. And then from the analysis of the data, interpretations are done. And these interpretations are basically helpful to make us to find out solutions to the problems which actually originated our research question. Fine. So let's suppose today, if a research question comes to my mind, that what is the total duration of illness of a patient who is affected by COVID-19. So my research question is that I want to assess that what is the total duration of affectedness of a patient by COVID-19 patient in general population. So what will I do? I will collect data from all those who are affected by the COVID-19. Now I have to specify here that whether I am interested in the duration of hospital stay or I am only interested in the duration of the illness, either it is in hospital or it is at home. So I will identify that from where I will collect my data. Either the patients of hospital will be my major source of data, or I will be collecting it from the general population. How I will be collecting this data, either through interviews or through observations or through hospital records. And then I will enter this data into specific softwares for the analysis. And then I will do interpretations. And I will calculate that what is the total duration of hospital stay of each patient in who is affected by COVID-19 in hospital. And then I will be taking means of all the data and I will say that the mean duration of hospital stay of COVID-19 patients is this day. So basically, research starts with a research question. A researcher collects data, he analyzes it, he interprets it, and he finds out solutions to the problem. Moving further, what are different types of research? Okay, the research can be divided into two different types. Number one, descriptive, and number two is analytical. In descriptive type of research, the researcher only describes the data. For example, if I'm interested in research of COVID-19, I will be calculating the numbers that what is the age distribution, who is affected greatly by the COVID-19, what is the gender distribution, how many males were affected, how many females were affected, which age group, for example, the elderly population was affected more. Then the number of patients who were getting admitted into hospital were this percentage, or the number of the patients who were dying because of the COVID-19 was this, the recovery rate was this, the PCR rate was this. So I'm only describing the data. I am not finding any association or causation of the data. If the researcher is only describing the facts, it means he is conducting a descriptive type of research. But if he is interested in finding out causation and association, then it becomes an analytical type of studies. In analytical research, there are further two subtypes. Number one is the observational research, and number two is the interventional or experimental research. In analytical research, basically, the researcher now wants to find out causes, he wants to find out associations, he wants to find out the risk factors, he wants to correlate things, and he wants to generate the new knowledge for the general population. If the researcher is conducting only observational studies, in which the researcher is only observing, and if the researcher wants to conduct the experimental studies, the researcher is now experimenting. Let me give you an example. In observation, the researcher is not manipulating any type of intervention. He is only observing what is happening around. For example, if he wants to see that how many of the patients who were infected with COVID-19 are causing secondary attack rate, it is an analytical type of research. And I have already told you that what is secondary attack rate. Secondary attack rate means the number of cases which are originating after the contact from the primary case within the same incubation period within the susceptible population. So if the researcher wants to find out the association of the development of secondary attack rate with a specific disease, he is not manipulating any type of intervention. He is not doing any intervention. He is just only observing. It means he is conducting observational studies. If the researcher is doing something to manipulate the outcome, it means he is conducting experimental studies. For example, if the researcher is giving some drug to the COVID-19 patient and he wants to see that what is the impact of this drug on recovery of these particular patients, or he can be giving the immunotherapy or plasma immunotherapy and looking into the recovery rate or the prognosis of the disease, or he is doing any intervention. Let's suppose he is giving some vaccine and he wants to see that how many of them are prevented to get the infection. It comes in the experimental studies. So in a nutshell, we will say that if a researcher is only describing the data, he is conducting descriptive research. And if he is analyzing the data in the form when he wants to develop association and causation, he is conducting analytical research. If he is only observing, it means he is conducting an observational study. And if he is doing something to change the outcome, for example, he is doing any intervention, he is giving some drug, he is giving plasma therapy, he is giving some vaccine, he is giving health education, this comes in the experimental studies. So this was one of the type of the classification of research. Moving further, another type of research categorization can be basic research and the applied research. The basic research basically consists of the research in which the researcher is interested in the basic phenomena. For example, he wants to know that how the COVID-19 is affecting physiology of the lungs, or what pathological changes are occurring in the lungs once the COVID-19 infection infects the lungs. So basically, the basic research is the research in which the basic phenomena and basic theories are being studied by the researcher. But when we talk about the applied research, it means now we want to see that if the researcher is doing some intervention, what is the impact of this intervention? Let me give you an example of applied research in such a way that, let me take an example of that the government of Pakistan is doing PCR testing of the international travelers who are coming from the United Kingdom. Fine. And then we are also asking those travelers to limit their interaction with the other general community. So we want to see that if the government is applying this restriction and is doing the PCR testing of the international travelers, how it has affected the prevalence or incidence of COVID-19 in the general community. It means that the researcher now wants to see that after doing some intervention, what impact is being produced after this intervention will come into the applied research. Another type of classification of research is the theoretical research and empirical research. And this, I will again give you the same example. In theoretical research, the researcher is basically involved in theories. He wants to generate theories. For example, the pathologists have given the theory that once the threshold level of COVID-19 is attained into the body, it produces interleukin storm. And this interleukin storm is basically dangerous, and it causes fibrosis of the lungs, and it causes decrease in oxygen saturation, and it makes the patient very critical. It means the researcher is involved in the generation of theories, that what theory is working behind it. But in case of empirical research, the researcher basically deals with the original data. He is not concerned with the theories. He is concerned with the original data. He goes into the field. He collects data there on patients, on living human beings, on animals, on birds, or any other thing. He conducts original research. He actually collects original data, and then he enters this data, he analyzes this data and find out the results. But in case of theoretical research, the researcher does not take the original data. He goes back into the books and into the journals and wants to find out that what are different theories which can end up in this phenomena. Fine. So as a researcher, we are involved basically with the empirical research. That is the requirement of the University of Health Sciences, that we will be collecting original data and then we will be analyzing it and then we will be making conclusions. So you must emphasize on the empirical research, that is the original research. Another type of classification of research is the qualitative research and quantitative research. The quantitative research means that we are dealing with quantities, we are dealing with numbers, we are dealing with the statistics, we are dealing with the variables which are quantifiable, we will be calculating them, we will be applying basic statistics on them, and then we will be generating results in the form of percentages, rates, proportions, or we will be involved in the indicators calculation, that what is the percentage of the survival, what is the percentage of the mortality, what is the morbidity percentage, how many males were affected, how many females were affected, etc., etc. So quantitative research is the research in basically in which we are concerned with numbers. But in qualitative research, the researcher is not very keen to count the number. and he is more interested in dealing with perceptions. He is more interested in dealing with behaviors, and which cannot be quantified. For example, we can count that how many children with thalassemia major are born every year in Pakistan. That will be quantitative research. And how many of them are males, how many of them are females, how many of them were related to cousin marriage, how many of them were counseled in pregnancy, how many were offered prenatal counseling, etc. These all questions come into the quantitative research. But the qualitative research will give us answers that how a parent feels to be a parent of a thalassemic child. What are their perception about the causation of this disease? How the society behaves towards a thalassemic child. It means we cannot quantify behaviors. We cannot quantify opinions. We cannot quantify perceptions. In that case, we are much more interested while conducting the qualitative research. The qualitative type of research is basically a descriptive research in which we deal with knowledge, we deal with perceptions, we deal with attitudes, we deal with behavior, and they are basically interpretive, and we cannot generalize their results. They are very, very specific results. Moving further, what are different types of qualitative research? The qualitative research, one of the example can be a historical research. For example, one type of the example of the historical research can be that we are facing pandemic of COVID-19, and I am interested in knowing the previous pandemics which have affected the world, and I go back into the history and find out that there were many pandemics which have affected a large number of geographical area, which included the bird flu pandemic, the influenza pandemic, cholera pandemic, plague pandemic. And I go back into the history and I find out that what were the factors which actually helped us in controlling those pandemics, what were the factors which helped us for the origination of the pandemic. So I will go back into the history and I will do my research based on the data which is available, already available in the form of books or journals or in the history books. So it is already present. Another type of qualitative research is the type of research in which we deal with different phenomena. And this is a type of qualitative research, again, and in which the researcher is basically involved in finding out that why this particular phenomena is occurring, why this phenomena cannot be changed, how this phenomena can be changed, what are the factors which can affect this phenomena, and why this particular phenomena is existing in the world. So it all depends and comes under the category of the phenomenology. Other types of qualitative research include grounded theory and ethnography. In grounded theory, the researcher is basically involved in finding something new which has never been done in the universe, or it has never been done in the human population. It is something innovative. The idea was never brought into the consideration. For example, I will give you an example of the grounded theory that before the pandemic, COVID-19 pandemic, it was never thought that the medical studies can be done through hybrid model or through by the online teaching alone. So now multiple theories have been originating which say that it is not important to invest into so much infrastructure or into taking into so much faculty into account, and we can run a hybrid model or online teaching in medical schools as well. So this is a novel idea. It was never thought of before. So it comes under the theory which is known as the grounded theory. Another type of qualitative research is known as ethnography. In ethnography, the researcher becomes the part of the community and he experiences whatever is happening in the community. For example, I will give you an example that in 2014 in Japan, atomic reactor was blasted, and there was release of atomic gases and atomic nuclear power radiations into the atmosphere. And the people who were residing in that community, they actually felt and wrote about that, what happened to the people around them, what were their day-to-day difficulties, how they survived, how many of them died, and what were the reasons of their death. So whenever the researcher is part of the community which is affected, and he actually writes his own experiences and the community's experiences in his own words, it is known as the ethnography. Let me tell you another example of the qualitative research. Another very important type of qualitative research is a case study. And in case studies, you only take one case. Let me give you an example. For example, during my PhD exam, we were asked to conduct a case study, and we took a female who were burnt by acid on her wedding day. And we took that case and we studied in detail that what were her problems and what were the factors which triggered that throwing of acid incidents by some of his relatives on her, and what are the basic problems through which she's passing through, how we can find out solutions for us, and how we can apply these results and present it in the community to present the case study. So in case study, we only take a single case, we conduct in-depth analysis, we conduct in-depth interviews, and these interviews are conducted in subsequent manner in such a way that the full saturation of data is attained. And then the case study is presented in the form of research article, is known as a type of qualitative research, which is known as case study. Let me tell you that for examination point of view, we are not interested in qualitative research. We will be conducting quantitative research, which is the requirement of University of Health Sciences, and we will be dealing with numbers. And we will be collecting original data, and we will be then analyzing this data through different softwares, and we will be applying different tests of significance to make the interpretations. So one decision today which we have done is that we will be conducting quantitative research, in which we will be dealing with original data, in which we will be dealing with numbers, and we will be presenting these numbers to the general community to show that these are the results of our research. When we talk about the data collection procedure, either it is qualitative research or it is quantitative research, we can collect data through while conducting the surveys. We can collect data by simple observations. We can collect data by the interviewing technique, or we can also collect data by collecting the documents which are present. Particularly this method of data collection is fixed for the qualitative research, but the rest are shared by the qualitative research and the quantitative research. In quantitative research, we can conduct surveys, we can do observations, we can conduct interviews, but the only difference between qualitative and quantitative research will be that we will be dealing with numbers and we will be dealing with original data when we are conducting quantitative research. What is action research? Action research is basically community-based participatory research in which some intervention is done by the government or by the community itself, and then its results are analyzed. For example, if in a community tuberculosis is prevalent in a high condition and government of Pakistan has launched one of the component of Pakistan TB control program in that area, we will be interested as researcher in what was the prevalence rate before this program and what is the prevalence rate of tuberculosis after this program. What was the incidence before this program? What is the incidence after this program? How many of people with tuberculosis were dying before the implementation of this program? And how many of them are now dying after the implementation of this program? So it is basically community-based participatory research in which the action is done and then the research is done to see that what is the impact of this particular action afterwards. This is health research triangle. We can conduct biomedical research in which we will be dealing with the health sciences, we will be dealing with patients, we will be dealing with the healthy individuals, we will be dealing with specific populations. Then the research can be conducted to see the behavioral research, that how the behavior has been changed after a specific intervention, or the research can be conducted to see the impact of the health system in a community. So whatever type of research you want to conduct, you can find out that what enchants you as a researcher. So moving further, now we have discussed that what are different types of research, and we have discussed that we will be conducting quantitative research, we will be dealing with numbers. So there are different steps of research methodology. There are different steps for research conduction. There are different steps for write-up of research. There are different steps which encompasses the areas of topic selection, then the literature review, then finalizing the methodology, and we will be discussing them one by one. So basically, what do we do? We steps in research is that we define a specific area. Let's suppose that you have selected an area of maternal mortality, which as a researcher enchants you that something should be done to see the impact, to see what is happening with high maternal mortality in Pakistan. Okay, this is the basic broader area. But now my question to you will be that what exactly do you want to see in maternal mortality? So there are multiple causes of maternal mortality. There are multiple interventions which can reduce maternal mortality. There are different medical reasons for maternal mortality. So I will define my problem. I will say that maybe the Pakistan has high maternal mortality rate because of pregnancy-induced hypertension. So my area of interest will be pregnancy-induced hypertension causing maternal mortality. So I have defined the problem. You can define the problem by fixing it that whether you are interested in knowing the basic description of that disease, you are interested in calculating rates, ratios and proportions, or are you interested in analyzing the cause-effect relationship, or are you interested in knowing the impact of an intervention in that group. So the researcher, according to his or her own interest, defines the problem. Then the researcher conducts thorough literature review. He formulates a hypothesis. He defines his methods, that how will be conducting his research. And then he goes into the field and collects the data. And after collection of data, he analyzes the data, he interprets the data, and he finds out solution to the defined problem. So the first step in conduction of research is defining the problem. So, while talking about the steps in conduction of research, the first thing will be when you define a problem, it means you are formulating a topic. After formulation of a topic, once your topic has been finalized, it means you have finalized your research objectives. Now, you will be interested in knowing that what are different variables which you will be using during this research and how you will be analyzing them. Then you will take a sample, you will develop tools, you will collect data, you will analyze the data, and you will write up your research report. This is basically the step in the conduction of research. When we talk about the write up, again, when you finalize your topic, you write that topic. Fine, that is, it means you have written a topic. You collect the background information by doing thorough literature search, and after collecting the information, you organize this information and you know that which of the people have cited it, and then you will start writing the draft in the form of introduction, methodology, results, and discussion. Once your write-up has been done, you will edit it, you will correct it, you will revise it, and you will submit your final draft. Your final draft is incomplete without the references. So we will be going through these steps one by one, and we will be discussing them in detail one by one. Today, we will only be discussing that how do you select a research topic? How do you formulate a question? For example, whenever you want to select a research topic, the most important thing which comes to your mind should be the relevance. For example, when I was discussing the titles of my research batches, many of them brought many good public health issues into consideration. For example, some of them said, I want to work in maternal mortality. Some of them said that we want to work in child abuse. Some of them said that we want to work in depressions among medical students. And some of them said that we want to find out that what are the factors which are involved in transmission of COVID-19. So you have to find out a topic which is very, very relevant. It has public health importance. For example, in Pakistan, if you will say that I want to conduct a research on Lyme disease, it is not of public health importance in Pakistan. If you will ask me that I am interested in conducting a research on COVID-19 nowadays, I will be very much interested because it has high relevance nowadays. If you will say me that we want to conduct study on tuberculosis, we want to study in high maternal mortality, we want to work on diseases which are preventable through vaccination. So these are all important public health issues in Pakistan, and they will carry high relevance and there will be more chances of being selected. Fine. The next criteria for the selection of research topic is that it should be innovative. You have to find out something new which has not been done. Many of you have sent me that we want to work on the menstrual disorders among the medical students. Lots of work has been done. Some of them said that we want to check the refractory errors of the medical students. Lots of work have already been done. Some of them said that we want to work on the depressive state of the medical students and suicidal thoughts. Lots and lots of literature is available on this topic. So find out something innovative. Find out something new which can contribute effectively in the knowledge of the general population. Find out something new which has not been worked before. Or there is less work done on that particular topic. Another important criteria for selecting a research topic is the feasibility. Let me tell you frankly that we have to select a topic which is very, very feasible for us, because we have to conduct the research during these 8 to 9 months of the academic year. We do not have funds. We cannot go for very high research in which lots of funding will be generated. Lots of funding should be generated for the conduction of research. Yes, we can collect data easily from Jaffa Sayid Medical and Dental College. Yes, we can collect data from Farooq Hospital. Yes, we can collect data from different hospitals. If you have access to those hospitals, because let me tell you frankly that whenever we will be going somewhere, we need to seek permissions for data collection. I will give you an example that 2 years ago we formulated a research project in which we wanted to find out that what are the physical health effects of the jail inmates in Lahore. So it took us about 6 months to take permission to go to jail and collect data there. So as you all know that we have to collect data personally, we have to collect the original data, we have to come into contact of those all people who are area of interest for us. We need to identify a feasible research. Let me give you another example. For example, if you bring an idea that we want to conduct the research and we want to find out that what are the changes which take place in the CT scan of ischemic stroke or hemorrhagic stroke. So you must know that how we will be assessing that data, which hospital will be your target, what will be the number of patients you want to include in that research, how will you be collecting that research. Is it feasible that every patient who comes with stroke goes for CT scan? So these are the questions which should come under the feasibility, and how much fund is required for the conduction of this research. So please do not opt for a very high standard research. We have to do, we have to confine ourselves within our feasible constraints. Then acceptability. It is important that while formulating our synopsis, while formulating our research topic, we should know that whatever we want to do is acceptable to the general population. Some of you have given me an example that we want to conduct studies on sexually transmitted diseases. Fine, it is very innovative, it is relevant, it is feasible, you have to conduct a survey. But is it acceptable for the general population to give you data on their sexually transmitted diseases? Will people be comfortable to tell you about the pattern of sexually transmitted diseases and their perverted sexual behaviors or their sexual behaviors? Will the community feel it acceptable project to be run? This is a question. So whenever you are designing a research project, you must know that is it acceptable by the general community or the general people on which you want to conduct the study, that they will give you their own data to you. Then another important thing is the cost effectiveness. For example, you ask me that we want to conduct the research on the vitamin D status of the medical students in Akhtar Singh Medical and Dental College. Okay, fine. It's a relevant idea. It is an innovative idea. But do you know that for each testing, the cost of assessment of vitamin D level will be almost about 2300 to 2500. So if your sample is about 100 or 150 students, then you can very easily assess that how this cost will be generated and who will be paying this cost to the hospital, and will you be asking the participants to spend their own money just for the sake of your research, and how many of them will be willing to spend that much for your research. So please formulate a research topic which is cost effective, which does not involve that much money. And then the last, the ethical considerations. During conduction of research, we must know that there are certain boundaries on which the researcher has to work. We have to take informed consent of the participant. We have to tell them that we are working on a research project. These are our objectives. We will be collecting your data. We will be analyzing it. Then we will be publishing it. Another ethical consent is that you have to take the Institutional Review Board permission. From wherever you want to conduct the study, you have to have the IRB clearance. You have to keep the data anonymous. You have to keep the data confidential. And you have to keep the data for next 3 years to justify your research. So these are basically the criteria for selection of a research topic. Whenever we talk about the selection of a research topic, we give it a number. So there is a total criteria. There are six criteria, and each criteria is given 3 marks. And then in the end, 6 into 3, the total marks becomes 18. And you give marks accordingly. For example, if you want to see that whether your topic is relevant or not, you want to see that how big is the problem, how important it is to find out solutions to it, is it a problem of a local setup. If all the 3 criteria are fulfilled, then you will give 3 marks in the relevance. If the disease is not that prevalent, if it is not that important, you will give two marks. And if it is not a disease of public health importance in Pakistan, you will give it 0 marks here. So going towards the innovation, innovation means has the topic been researched before or are you looking into something new? So sometimes the innovation carries 3 marks, but at your level, we do not think that you will be bringing something very innovative. So if you secure 2 marks or 1.5 marks here, it will be okay for us. Let's move forward. For feasibility, you have to consider the resources that are required to carry out the project. You need to how much human resource will be required, how much material will be required, how much money will be required to meet the objectives. And then according to the feasibility, you have to give marks out of 3 again for the feasibility. Acceptability is a research, a topic which has been interest or the support of the authorities. Whether the college will fund you, whether your teachers will support you, whether the community will accept your research proposal, whether the community will be willing to answer your question comes in the category of the acceptability. Next question is cost effectiveness in case of time, money and material. Again, you have to check that what is the total fund which is required for the conduction of the research proposal, and you have to give marks out of 3 for the cost effectiveness. And then the ethical considerations, we have discussed that you have to keep into consideration the cultural sensitivity. You cannot just go in the community and you can ask about the sexual partners, or you cannot ask about the extramarital affairs, or you cannot ask about sexually transmitted diseases. You cannot ask about alcohol abuse. You cannot ask about drug abuse. So you have to think about the cultural sensitivity. You have to be vigilant about informed consent and the 4 principles of the medical ethics as well. So by taking into consideration 3 marks for each criteria, the total marks are 18, and you will be giving it on the score of 1 is for low and 2 is for medium and 3 is for high. If your research proposal gets more than 12 marks out of 18, it means your proposal is workable. So please, before submitting your finalized research title to us, go through this exercise, and if your title secures more than 12 marks out of 18, please submit your title to the supervisor. And let me emphasize here that we are running short of time and we have to finalize your titles within 1 week. Please submit your titles over the weekend, so we'll be working on it, and then we will be finalizing 1 topic during this week. So the next lecture will be done on literature search regarding the research methodology. Thank you so much. If you have any questions, you can ask me. Thank you.